I'd just like to introduce Ratish to all of you. Ratish Radhakrishnan teaches at the Department of Humanities and Social Sciences in IIT Bombay. He completed his PhD from the Center for the Study of Culture and Society here in Bangalore. He's currently a part of the India programming team of MAMI, Mumbai Film Festival. His research on Malayalam cinema has appeared in a variety of journals and other publications, both in English and Malayalam. So I don't think we could have had a better person for this conversation. Over to you.
Thank you. Thanks, Subhashree, for this opportunity. It's not always that you get a chance to speak to a director that you really enjoy watching films of. So I know I'm encroaching upon your time to ask questions too, so I'll quickly get on with some of my questions and hand it over to you guys. I find this exercise a bit strange to some ways, because all of us here encounter the film as a product. Like, we watch the film after it's done, it's all done, it's, but you, your relationship with the film clearly is some other kind of relationship. So there are some expectations from our parts which we will put on you, and so on and so forth. Let's see how that goes. So the first question I wanted to ask you is precisely about this. What is your relationship with a film once it's done? I mean, we get time to think about it, watch it, and think about it in relation to other films and so on. Do you think about your film after it's done?
Only when you people talk about it.
That's right. I knew that was going to come. So apart from that, do you think about it? Here is a setup. We are putting you in a spot. You have to think about it. Apart from that?
I enjoy this kind of interaction, basically. Yeah. That's what I enjoy from filmmaking. You, mm-hmm. The making part is the best, the process. And then an interaction where people, again, address directly. You know, that's the best thing. More than the main mainstream release space. This is more enjoyable. You have a one-to-one. Mm. You get a proper feedback and you get to listen to different perspectives about it. You get to listen to what you have missed out on. It's a lot of things. So I quite enjoy it anyway.
So that's good. At least I know he enjoys it. So that's good. In some ways, what I will be asking you are impressions coming from the US space, and asking you to see if you could think from the practitioner's world. You might need not respond directly to my questions. You can respond from what you do and how you do it. So Rajiv, as we all know, has worked as a cinematographer for the longest time and has made 3 films. And one of the interesting things, if you look at his filmography, is the fact that a lot of these films are set in cities in one way or the other. So that was an interesting, there are a few films which are not, but there are a lot which are set in cities. And there is a way in which one can actually think about very different relationship that these films seem to have with cities. So if you look at films that he shot for Anurag Kashyap, like Devdi or That Girl in the Yellow Boots, which also you shot, right? Yeah. So if you look at those kind of films, you see that the city appears as a certain kind of delirious space, almost kind of the subject of the character is the city in some sense, bright colors and delirious kind of world. When it comes to Anneem Rasoolum, which is your first film, I felt that the camera, your eye, was kind of embedded in the city, seems to be kind of moving, at least in the first 3/4 of the film, there seems to be a floating kind of an eye that the camera has. When it comes to Steve Lopez, which is the second film, Steve Lopez begins with a song which kind of maps the city, which talks about different places in the city of Trivandrum, not Kochi. And kind of that kind of mapping from a certain point of view of a certain administrative logic, right? I mean, state's logic seems to be very central to Steve Lopez. When it comes to Kammattipaadam, on the other hand, which is not about Kochi, strictly, this is a distinction that people in Kochi make, which is between Kochi and Ernakulam. Kochi being Fort Kochi and Ernakulam being the mainland. So Kammattipaadam is set in the mainland, in Ernakulam, not in... So when it comes to Kammattipaadam, there is a way in which the film has a certain kind of an epic kind of scope to it, and characters are kind of growing parallel to the city. So there's a kind of allegorical relationship between the characters' lives and the city's life. Now, these are things that a viewer puts together. When you are starting working on a film about a city, do you have specific thoughts prior? Do you plan things about your relationship with the city? How does this, I mean, and I'm not just talking about shooting, in terms of scripting, the entire process, how do you think about a city? So you can give with an example, talk with an example, or otherwise.
See, practice-wise, I am more I have more experience in cinematography. So this is something which I have been trying and I've been practicing actually. We're working with Anurag also. Space is very important for me. Like if I'm shooting in Banaras, I actually try and get to know the, I go and stay there for a, before the shoot for some time, and that helps me a lot. I don't know how, but it helps me. So when I started making films, for me, the space was important. Where will I sit and in Rasulam? So that was Kochi and Vaipin, two islands, kind of space, and the life. So I can't see, I don't know, it might be a drawback also, but I somehow, for me, the space is very important. Only then the story also goes ahead, the things fall in place for me. And shooting-wise also, as an execution part also, it becomes easier for me. When I have certain limitations or certain, I don't know what, the space, the roads, the buildings, it all helps me in like seeing through the characters and setting it up. Is that it?
No. No, I was also thinking that, so for example, if one were to put you in a spot as we are doing, to think about a new city, like for example, if I say that you made a film on Kochi and you filmed at Trivandrum, if I would say, how would you start thinking about Calicut as a space or something? How, I mean, would you be able to kind of start a thought? Would it be possible?
First of all, if I go to, if I, I love Calicut as a city and I'm not that well, I don't know that city that well. So if I have to do a thing, I have to play something, what I will do is I will go and stay there for some time and get used to that space, the people there, the language, and then I will get into whatever writing also. Because Kamattipadam was written, the first thing was written, it was my first idea. Because I actually witnessed what happened in this film. I actually witnessed the changeover. I grew up in a small town. Ernakulam was a big city, not a big city, a small town actually in 90s. Actually in mid 90s only the traffic junctions came up, the signals came up. So it was a small place, but the change which has happened was, it was kind of an explosion from 90s. After the liberalization, 96 onwards the growth started, and now it's a huge city with the metro also. So I couldn't help, like, I couldn't forget this thing which I've witnessed. I've seen this thing happening. And I've seen people also. I've seen the people who had to be, who had to go away from the city and go out into the suburbs and take up their places. So I started looking at it as an encroachment. Encroachment. Whose encroachment? Who is encroaching into these lands? Like, so the initial part is the state is encroaching. Not encroaching, state is actually taking over these lands. What I witnessed in Cochin was there's a body called the GCDA, Greater Cochin Development Authority, which is not a new thing. Everywhere they had, a Bombay, Mumbai, they had, every city has that. But what in Kochi I witnessed was they actually, the word they used was acquired these lands and they were sealed. You could not sell them. They were all paddy fields. And then slowly these lands were filled. So we were kids, we were happy because we got cricket pitches, nice place to play. And then slowly these partitions came up. And then we realized that these have been all sold to the private parties. It's not in the government was acting as a real estate agent there. GCDA was actually a real estate agent. So these things which, these things have happened in Mumbai also. In every city it has happened. But when it happened in front of me and I had to actually witness the throwing out of people, like people disappearing from our, my neighborhood people, my friends which I played with and all, they were, they had to like actually disappear from the city, which is a so-called development happening. So my question, my thing was, Kamattipadam came up from this question of the development, the agenda behind this development which is happening around us. It's kind of an exploration into that area, basically.
No, that's interesting, because I think one of the things I wanted to ask you later, but I'll ask you now, is in some sense, unlike your other two films, the main character in Kamattipadam, like unlike Unnamed Rasoolam and Steve Lopez, the main character in Kamattipadam also has a witness kind of a role, right? He is one person who has an exit from the city. If you look at, Rasool does exit at the end after a point, but Steve has no exit, he dies, right? He has an exit and he can come back and he can witness the city. So that's an interesting relationship. And, and interestingly, one of your actors, I think he's more than an actor, Vijay Kumar, who plays Majid in the film, says in an interview, passing very vaguely, he says, but Krishnan is director, and then he moves on in an interview about the film. So, I mean, what your relationship with Kochi and how Krishnan is conceived? Because there is Bombay, there's going to Bombay, coming back. I mean, I don't want to make too much of a like an autobiographical parallel, but that witnessing role, which I think the other two films do not
give their heroes.
Yeah, Cochin has a very, Ernakulam has a very, I'm also used to using the word Cochin because people know only Cochin, they don't know Ernakulam. This Ernakulam, very personally, I have seen these things and I left Cochin, Ernakulam in 93. It was a small town. So every time I used to come back, something was changing there. Yeah, definitely there is a very personal, it is a, what you have seen. So yeah, that is there, definitely there. Krishnan is a witness, he is a witness, purely a witness who had to go through, but then he, in my earlier version, he was not doing anything, he was a helpless guy who had to just witness it. But then I kind of made a very strong decision to put the last scene there, which was forceful, but I had to do that. I wanted to like finish that witness spectator thing from me.
I will come to that last scene because I think it is something to talk about. But you said something that I thought was interesting because again, when I was watching Kamathipadam, one of the things I thought was Kamathipadam as a place, the real place Kamathipadam is next to the bus stand and railway station and so on, right? So like you said, it is a state that first encroaches upon this space. But interestingly, unlike Steve Lopez, where the state is omnipresent, the state is kind of absent in Kamathipadam. Like for example, it's actually the real estate agent, And there's a policeman, but a side kind of a role that comes one at the beginning and then at the end. But other state players seems to be absent. Now, was that something you had? Do you think about it? Which I thought was interesting, precisely because of this reason. The first encroachers were the state. So
that was intentional, but there is a mention of GCD in one of the scenes. But I didn't want to because they are always invisible. Like if you have seen Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. There is this people chasing these guys, but you never get to see their faces. They're faceless. You just see them from long shots, their hands, their back shots. You don't see their faces. They are faceless, but they are always chasing these guys. So I just wanted to have this feeling still be an invisible force behind common people who are like executing it.
Also, this thing about character. So going back to all your films that you've done, how does the film begin in your idea? Does it begin with a character? Or is it, so for example, to take Steve as an example, because Steve Lopez is set in Trivandrum. So how did Steve Lopez as a character emerge? What was the first thought? Whose thought was it? Again, you can talk about it, Kamathipadam, you said it was your first idea. So clearly it's you very centrally there. But apart from that, the other two films, how general practice, where does it start with the character?
Steve Lopez was the character basically. Steve Lopez was made first and then I decided to place it in Trivandrum because Trivandrum is the capital. So it was intentionally kept there. Steve Lopez was basically for the college, that age group, because we had this tendency of blaming these people always. Like whenever we go back to a campus, we say that it's not like earlier days. It's like people are like not reading, they're not seeing films, they're like dumb. But I realize it's not their fault, it's our fault. We couldn't pass on the information which we got from our seniors. We were never there because 90s onwards, all of us got busy and we never turned back and looked at them. So it is actually the problem with the elders, the brothers, the fathers who got sold out. So I just wanted to make a story out of that, explore the relationship between a father and a son, where the father is actually sold out and son gets to realize it. So I wanted to actually get the personal thing out more than, so the state was a very, capital city was chosen for that.
And how did Arne Vasoolam begin? What was the initial?
Romeo and Juliet. So Romeo and Juliet with Fort Kochi as a Romeo's thing and Waipin as a Juliet's place and one channel going between them.
It started with Romeo and Juliet as
well. Romeo and Juliet.
Okay. So that's very, The other thing that I always wonder is about the genre itself. Like there's this gangster narrative, and in some sense, I was thinking about Daddy, which came out just recently, and so on, with very different kind of aesthetic ideas, narratives. There seems to be certain things that are common to the gangster narrative. I mean, it seems to be a kind of trapping of the gangster narrative. For one, to give you an example, would be a nostalgia for friendship, which seems to be underlying every gangster film, right? There seems to be something about that kind. Now, this nostalgia also in some sense translates to a certain nostalgia for an organic community that is lost. There's something that we lose kind of a thing. I say this also because if you look at the specifically Malayalam cinema's history, so the first part of the film, Kamathipadam, is set in the early 80s because Tagara, 78, 80s, you see Tagara poster of this film, Tagara, one of the sequences, 78, 80. In 80s Malayalam cinema, you see two kinds of representations of Kochi. One, in a film like Adi Orukugal, Ivy Shashi or something, you see the Fort Kochi as a village, like people coming there and so on and so forth. Whereas Orakapuruthu, same time, you see it as a very urban kind of a space. But in Kamathipadam, 80s, this area, and I'm sure it was also like that, like there's a realistic issue there. But there's also, it lends to a certain, some kind of a nostalgia for a organic community. And friendship, for me, is very central to this nostalgia. So, is that a trap that all gangster films will have to
fall into? This trap, when we talk in contrast with this practice, the practice has a negative effect also. Like, I have realized that when I started working in Malayalam industry and started doing the mainstream cinema, you fall into this practice of, it becomes mechanical after a point. Even the narrative, even scenes, construction of scenes, even characterizations. So to escape from that, I mean, we need more practice. Like, more practice in different areas. And about this categorizing cinemas in the gangster flick and all, it's a very easy way. Even the distributors and exhibitors also like have the tendency of categorizing these cinemas and putting them in places. But I believe in a, I don't see Kamathipadam as a gangster flick, but it is easy to say as a gangster film. And people have been talking about it as a gangster film. For me, it is not a gangster film. So I think it's the market also is responsible for this this kind of categorization which is coming in. For me, Kamathipadam is a very personal love story, friendship story. But there are, yeah, definitely there is this nostalgic thing, there is this pattern coming in. But I think we can't help it because we have been watching films, a lot of films, you know, so films inspire you in a lot of way, and readings also. For me, literature is also very inspiring in a way. So these things, these characters, you might find similarities with a lot of things. Can't help it.
I was not talking about similarities as a problem. I was just saying that it's interesting to see that there's a certain iteration of certain tropes. In again, it's not as though Daddy and Kamathipadam is the same, is similar. Of course it's not. But there seems to be something in the structuring of these narratives which has to follow certain kind of patterns, which I thought was interesting to think about. Again, the other problem, connected to nostalgia, because you also say it's a personal film, so in some sense it's also nostalgia of friendships in some sense, and so on, which also makes it a very gendered world. No? Now, if you all your films, character, the women characters are interesting. Like, for example, I found Anna very interesting. I find, what's the name, Kamathipadam, Anita, very interesting. But some ways, when earlier I said about the parallel between the character's arc and the city's arc. But in that, the woman characters do not seem to feature. Because the character arc seems to be male actors. So again, I'm not putting you in a spot, but I'm just kind of like...
I'm used to this because all my films, people have been telling me this. But this is something, this is something which naturally comes out, you know. You're from a society which is like this, so I can't, it is a problem, seriously a problem, which I might get over.
Making it no problem. Actually saying that it's interesting to see that.
Yeah, but just somebody who just, one of my friends, she left after the interval, she told me, I don't want to see this Mallu male cinema anymore.
But it's also interesting to think about, probably it's also about a collective ways in which we think about the city, not just the filmmaker, where the city's arc is told in certain tropes, including this nostalgia for friendships and so on, which cannot accommodate women in a particular, in the public sphere, in the way mainstream imagination goes, right? So that imagination might be something that...
If you look at my memory also, I have seen whatever you see, whichever characters you see in Kamathipadam, the female characters, it's all what actually Anita happened to be, she ended up in a petrol pump. That's what I see in Ernakulam. I know my friends' wives doing the same job. Like a lot of them in a lot of petrol pumps and a lot of these supermarkets. So it is actually from their farm land. They ended up in a thing. This is what I have witnessed. And moreover, this is a story where Anita is a very strong character. But might be because of the presence of a lot of other things that got a bit subdued.
So I think in some sense, I mean, again, talking about this nostalgia for friendship and organic community and so on, if you look at when you it's also like things about how we start the story in terms of like these two boys actually meeting and so on. So clearly the story is also set in an arc of male friendships, right? So which creates a situation where the female character then can only play a certain, I mean, which I think again is part of the genre, right? There's a certain way in which it works and so on. So that's, yeah, so. Again, interestingly, again, I found two characters which actually not Anita, who actually have an arc. Both underdeveloped. I know there's a longer cut of the film. I know that it's possible that those characters are developed there. So Juhi, who's his girlfriend in Bombay, and Rosamma are two characters I thought had an arc which is different from Anita's, which had something to do with the arc of the city. Slightly in terms of different kind of labor, probably different kind of engagement with the city. Are they part of the longer cut? Is there a narrative?
Juhi has a longer version, and Rosamma also has a not an end, but backstory to everything. There's a section where she's explaining her space in that cinema also, because Rosamma had a character in mind, one person, one. I think she's arrested now or something. There's a person who actually used to coordinate activities in Ernakulam city, and she used to actually coordinate all these main gangsters. So we can't say that women are.
No, the background to this is that there is a 4-hour cut of the film, and Rajiv says that it's almost ready. So we can look forward to some of these narratives and see, to reformulate some of these things and see how it actually works. One of the most interesting and shocking thing for me, surprising thing for me, was something that I told you I had written something on Kochi films and so on, and I had actually written something about Vinayagan, who's the hero who plays Ganga in the film, in that paper, which was written much before this film and so on, where I'd made a connection between Vinayagan and an 80s actor. This 80s actor is this guy called Achangunya. Achangunya was an actor from 1980s to 86 roughly, who was central to mostly a rural rustic kind of film practice, Bharathans and so on, I.B. Shashi and so on in Malayalam. And somewhere I'd made an argument that like Achangunya almost bodily presented the rural rustic. In a way, Vinayagan in the 2000s is doing the urban. And then I found something very strange. I don't know if you thought about this, but this is about casting. Finally, the question about casting. Josa, the rowdy that comes in the beginning, where the kids, the Ganga and Krishnan looking with fear and admiration, was strikingly like Achangunya. Like in some bodily thing. So that, I was actually like taken aback by that connection. So casting wise, did you have something of that kind in mind, or it's because you got an actor who like that, looked like that, and a larger question about general casting, and I'm sure everybody wants to know about the kids and all that, so.
Casting was that I had seen that person in real life, this Josa. He was a little more drained out version of that person. But he had that look, which Achangunya also had. Josa was a interesting casting, and then for me the most difficult was Vinayagan. I was not getting anybody. Vinayagan was my last choice actually. I was trying to, get somebody else, but I couldn't find an actor. Mm. And finally I ended up, because Vinayagan is from Kamatipadam. Mm. He was born and brought up there. So it became easy for me after a point. And the kids also, kids casting was very difficult. I had
so
to get the similar
look. Doing that. So, for example, this Josa, this actor, Who is he? Where did you find him? Like Achangunya has an interesting story. Like when Bharathan wanted to make an adaptation of La Strada, he was looking for an actor with Lori. Finally, he made a film called Lori, and he finds Achangunya to play the role Anthony Quinn played in La Strada. So you can imagine the figure. He was actually a laborer in a market in Kollam. So I mean, there's an interesting story of casting there. So, what is your...
This guy is a theatre actor, actually.
He's a theatre actor?
Yeah. Most of Kamatipadam people are like from theatre and then aspiring kids, you know, from schools and all. Mm. Casting was a difficult thing. We took almost 6 months to do the casting, one by one.
And I am told that there were a set of people doing casting for you?
Group
of people?
Yeah.
We can take some questions now, and then I can come back to some of the things that I want to.
Hello Raju, thanks for the wonderful film. I had a very good time watching it. So you said that you had witnessed the entire event and this episode. How much time did it take for you to, you know, gather all that, make characters. Can you tell us about your writing process?
I started in 2010 actually, 2010. Almost six, seven years, yeah. It went on for a long time. I made Anira Zulum, I made Steve Lopez, and then I finalized this. Because one difficult part was the execution portion. It needed money, it was a big project. The scale was quite big. So it took time. The writing, actually I enjoyed doing it also. But still it was not finished. It got over during shoot.
So in this context, there's something interesting to ask. Rajiv gave what later became a controversial interview in which he said scripts should be burned or something like that. And then everybody took umbrage to it and there was a huge hullabaloo about it. I mean, so it's interesting to ask about your writing process. Also because I realized that, like you told me before and also from the making video and so on, the editor, for example, was part of the shooting. The writing was going on. Like you said, the ending was an issue. So what's the, like, how did the project come together? Like, there's the editor, there's the writer. The writer is also the one who plays Krishnan's father, the same guy. Then you, the set of people. So how did the process come together? Like,
making of the film. Mm-hmm. Yeah. See, that's why I enjoy the process. You know, it happens while shooting. Mm. So the script is definitely there. I have a major text proper, not a script, but a progression of events made up in my mind initially, and then I just go on shooting. Script, scenes and characters, we add on slowly, and I enjoy that kind of process. The word is overused, but it's organic. I feel it's kind of an influence from Anurag also. I started working with him in Gulal, and from then on, Devdi, even Vasipur and all this, we have been shooting in places. We go to a place and we find places and we use the people around there and try to get that ambience from that. So that practice actually made it easier for me. When I got into Fort Kochi for Anirin Rasoolum, that way of executing the process was easier for me. I could actually control the scene with the crowd and all. In a busy street, I could actually manage to get out a scene. That practice helped me a lot with Anurag.
Well, this is interesting that you say this, because in an interview, Fahad Fasil talks about acting in Anirin Rasoolum, and he says that it was the first time that he felt that the lens will follow me. I don't have to follow the lens, was what he said. That you didn't have to act looking at a hand or whatever. And he says that there was a continuity issue that he told Rajiv, and Rajiv said, doesn't matter, act. So how do you work with actors in these kind of situations? That's an interesting...
That's one thing which I've practiced with Anurag. Basically what we do is, if we go to a room or something, we don't set up the camera and I'll tell the actors to come and act in front of it. We ask them to not perform, but execute the scene, like how they do it. And then we set up the blocks or whatever frames, or it might be one single shot, it might be like several shots, but we don't look at breaking it down. We actually take it from what is happening there, like sculpting in time.
So clearly the actors clearly seem to have a different relationship with your filmmaking, and yeah. Did working with these different actors, was it different, like working with Fahad, Dulkar, Vinayagan, how did they react to your process? I mean, all the other actors in the film, actresses.
I enjoyed doing it, so I don't think they had a problem. They never stopped me from doing it. But I think it's actually, they're in an advantageous position, because it is good for the actors. You're letting them loose. They can do whatever they want. They don't have to bother about their camera, their positioning, their angle. They just have to perform, or they just have to give everything to it. We will capture it. Even Vasipur also, I remember Vasipur exactly this kind of a process. Very organic, and the actors were also actually in sync. Manoj Vajpayee is in a very beautiful mood, and he used to like just walk around like Sardar. We just had to capture him. I think actors are ready to do it. Good actors will definitely be ready to do it.
Could you think of a moment in Kamatipadam where the actors just took the scene somewhere else that you did not expect? Something of that kind, where the actors surpassed your plan?
We always do, actually. That's our plan is actually just half of it. The rest you are trying to get it from them, from everyone, from not just from the actors. I look for contributions from every part of the crew. It has to happen there, otherwise it does not work. Something has to happen which we can't define. Some energy has to develop there.
Just record. And I'm more curious with the outsider's perspective, because I'm always curious to know how this happens on sets. It's not the cast I'm talking about, it's the city and the people who shoot. I remember these older films back in 90s and 80s when you remember any song which happens on the street, you have people standing around them, and then we just accept, take it for granted that okay, well, that's the film. Versus now, if I've particularly seen like the scene in the train, he's coming and sitting, where all of them actors or anything shoot in public, are those actors, are they real? How do you manage to sort of tackle that?
See, the train thing was a set. There was a set in Bombay, one of those, one bogey, one compartment was made. But actually, the advantage of this time is technology. The digital technology is helping us a lot. We have different kind of tools which we can actually hide and shoot. We can have multi-camera. Earlier days, it was not possible because of a lot of limitations. But still, we used to do those days. But now it is like we have small cameras you can hide anywhere. You have a GoPro which you can hide. You can shoot anything now. So it's easy now, but still the problem is in the practice is we have this tendency of going with a certain pattern of seeing, looking at, if you want to do a street scene, there is a fixed practice of executing that scene. You don't go beyond that. You're used to seeing that scene. The reference is there in your mind. So it actually automatically comes to that kind of frames. So I got a de-schooling, or I came out of that with Anurag. Till then I was practicing the same thing. I used to do the same thing. It was easier. It was like a mechanical process. You have a certain scene, you know how it's going to happen. Because you have several references of that. A classroom scene happening, you know how to shoot it. Because you know where to place a light, you know where to place a camera. Just the people facing me and one professor, you know where to put the camera, you know where to put the light. So it becomes very mechanical. So every scene, a bedroom scene, a classroom scene, a hospital scene, everything, is, you have clear references. Getting out of the reference point is a very, that is what you have to break.
Hello.
First of all, congratulations for the wonderful movie. My doubt is usually urbanization or concrete forest, usually people think, of farmers losing their land. In your film, this chemical background, how come to your mind, sir?
What background?
Usually in urban...
Sir,
usually when we think urbanization or concrete forest, or people will losing their land. My English is not good.
No problem.
Farmers, usually we will think of farmers losing their lands, and usually the story will come to in our mind of the farmers only. So in your film, how this criminal or bag canvas has come?
See, what happened was, these people are also farmers. People who were in Kamattipadam means padam, it's paddy fields. They were also farmers, but the plan was such that they stopped farming there years back, and then they somehow managed to stop the salt water getting in and going out. That program was somehow broken. The farming stopped there. So they had the right to go and encroach these lands. Nothing was happening. It was wasteland. I remember the city, Ernakulam city, as a place from the station, if you look, you could see just barren paddy field kind of place where agriculture was not happening for years. So it had to be acquired. It was like nothing was happening there. So people couldn't sell it also. So the GCDA took over all these lands. So they were actually farmers. Farmers turned into daily wages, laborers in different houses doing small kind of jobs. Some of them getting into criminal activities also. But they were not all of them were criminals. See, my worry about Kamattipadam is Kamattipadam will eventually, I have this reference of Bombay in the beginning of the film. See, Kamattipadam eventually might become a big slum. It has the possibility of it because that is, it's by the side of the rail, near the station, near the bus stand. So it might, in like 10 years, it might become a huge slum. It is not a slum even now, but it might become a huge slum area. Same thing will happen what happened in Bombay. Or in Trivandrum also the same thing has happened.
I think in terms of characters, if you follow that in the film text, if you think about the grandfather who dies just before the interval, the father who's a bit of an ineffective kind of a character, he's not a very active guy, whereas the grandfather is actually quite a strong character. And then there's Balan and Ganga. It's an interesting kind of a historical tracking there. whether there's a time when something happens, when things are made ineffectual in a particular manner. So you can actually think of it in those terms of what, who the grandfather was, what they were doing, because there's an initial sequence of that, that pond being cleared and so on, right? There's some, that, so there's some indications of that kind there, yeah. One more thing.
As in, how did you shortlist Balaton to write the script? Because his past movies were like, you know, Pavitram and Punarathivasam. And what made you think that he can do justice? I mean, there is no question about that. But, and another thing is that, did we lose anything? Because the entire movie length was much more, it seems, right?
It's actually a 4-hour movie. I had to cut it down for the theatre release.
What did we lose? What did we not see?
I'm bringing it up about the 4-hour cut, actually. And Balaton was my first choice. And because
just
I
to clarify, Balaton, the reference to Balaton is B. Balachandran, who, like I said, is a scriptwriter, also acts as Krishnan's father, who's a well-known theatre person, director, and now a very popular actor in this kind of roles also, also teaches theatre academically. So that's the reference to Balaton.
See, I like the way Balaton treats characters, the drama which comes out from, so I wanted that. I can't write. I can't create that kind of drama. So I actually wanted his contribution, whatever I could get from him. So that is, he was my first choice. He was with me from 2010. We wrote it together from those days, actually.
So it's also, there is one, on the one hand, there is the city in the film, the, as it's represented and so on. But there's also another development related to city that this entire process is part of, which is actually a shift in Malayalam cinema's organization itself. A certain dyad, which is Trivandrum, Madras, shifting to Kochi, Bombay as a certain axis, which I think has changed Malayalam cinema centrally, and Rajiv is very important player in this. Amal Neerad probably is slightly, like, did that move earlier. Amal Neerad, this is other director who initially worked with Ram Gopal Verma and so on. So how do you see this shift in industrial terms, like in terms of Malayalam film industry? What does the shift indicate for you, and what is your thoughts about that shift?
For me, Kerala is an easier place to work in, like make films. I don't have to handle a lot of people like Bombay, and it takes a shorter time. In Kerala, for me to make a film, it takes only 6 months, max 8 months. Bombay will take 2 years. So it is a very easier market for me to make films.
But also I'm thinking in terms of you, Amal, all these people having some relationship with Bombay in terms of filmmaking. Whereas earlier the relationship was between some people in Trivandrum and Chennai. So do you see a shift there? Because Kochi has emerged as a place of filmmaking, which it wasn't before in a particular manner. Which post-production
the reason can be that Kochi has emerged as a bigger city also.
Right, exactly. So this Bombay reference in some sense that way is interesting. Like a friend of mine who lives in Ernakulam, who watched Kamathipadam, told me that shot that you have from that island to Bombay, it's almost like the Fort Kochi shot to Ernakulam. So there's some kind of visual parallels also there in some sense.
Yeah.
There's also actual parallels that Amal, for example, Amal Neerad's one of his films called Big B. So there are characters that move between Bombay and so on. So there's some axis which is both industrial and narrative, because you guys work these places and there's some connection. So
can be a very personal thing also.
Of course, absolutely. But has it done anything to Malayalam film industry? This shift, this Kochi, this Trivandrum Kochi, that entire move?
Not necessarily, because the recent one, Thundimuthal and Thriksakshi, which came out, was a brilliant film which they didn't have any connection with this industry. But they must have had an exposure to that kind of watching films, but technically.
So you're still involved?
But yeah, a kind of technical exposure and exposure to a lot of other people must have helped. But Bombay,
anything? Yeah.
Thanks for bringing out the mindfulness. I was quite shocked when I saw the hero is Ayasthi and Anita, Krishna and Anita, she is casted. The hero is very kind of even the blessing and Anita is simple. So was it a very conscious choice, fair and dark?
Yeah, definitely it was a conscious thing. Should I go into that in detail or that? Because and it was very difficult to find a dark person to act. As Anita, I couldn't find a person actually. I couldn't find somebody who could speak Malayalam properly. there was nobody around. It's all almost whoever came wanted to like darken their skin and acting. Finally, I got a person from Bombay, from Bangalore, a Malayali girl. That was very intentional, very conscious decision. Kamatipadam actually the base or the strongest thing is that there is a basic idea behind it. See, I was talking to Ajit also, but this is this thing about Amar Chitra Kadas, which had a major influence in our life, where you see fair-skinned devas and dark asuras, and which we have been following for years, which was like our, that is the first visual thing we have. So Vinayak and I gave those buck tooth because of that. I wanted to make him more uglier in that sense, you know, uglier, ugly, what is ugly, ugliness about? People had problems with that, but something which I was trying in that, like a narrative which is strong in our mind, which we have been, even still exists, like what you're saying. So I want to try that out and turn it around. Like when people come out of Kamatipadam, they like Vinayagan more than the other one. Did it work that way?
There's also the question of who's the hero of the film, right? There's also that in some ways. If I can ask one more about the particular about the film, about the ending. I mean, and I actually wanted to know, because in terms of the film style, I thought there were two moments in the film which were kind of declarative, if I can say that, which is one, whereas the film actually takes on a kind of narrative arc. There are two moments of interruption. One is the end, where it has to interrupt and stop at a in a particular way. The other is when Balan realizes something is going wrong and almost gives an argument against these real estate developers and say, I won't be part of this anymore and so on. That seems slightly out of the narrative because it was making a point, right? The second time it was making a point was at the end. Like it actually, there's a bit of a speech at the end, right? And it some way does it didn't fit with the, I mean, I'm not saying it didn't work. It was not of the same register as the rest of the film. So how was the ending conceived? Was it like this all the time? You said the ending, you had some thought about it. Did it come later? What are the other options that you had?
Kamatipadam is the presentation or the whole structure of Kamatipadam comes after Steve Lopez. Steve Lopez was more of a newcomer, a completely no market oriented or mainstream kind of compromises, what we people call compromise. So that didn't work. For me, communication is very important. I want people to see the film. That's why I'm interested in cinema, because whatever I want to express has to be like, it has to reach people. Steve Lopez, nobody saw Steve Lopez. Nobody saw. So Kamatipadam, the idea had to be, it has to reach across to all these people in Kerala at least. So I wanted to make it in a, I didn't want Krishnan to just be a witness, you know. Because that role is happening everywhere. We're not doing anything. So that point had to be made also. That's why Kamatipadam had these, and I wanted Balan to speak out specifically because of these reasons. I wanted to be more vocal, because we have this Malayalam cinema narrative where everything is spoon-fed. Yeah. It has to be not just Malayalam cinema, almost whatever we have here. It's all, everything is dialogue. Everything is like, so it had to be there to like reach across to a larger audience. So I did it intentionally.
So where, was it always the plan, the end, or what did it emerge?
In the back of my the climax scene was created in the on the process itself. Like.
That's what I asked. So what were the other things that you were toying with? If you want to.
The other toying was Krishnan's death. That's it.
Krishnan's death. Okay. Anything? Yeah.
Sir. Having seen three of your films, one thing which kind of struck me is it's also about kind of dysfunctional families in a way. In Unnamed Rasoolam, it's Anna with her father, and in Jan Steve Lopez, although it's not very explicitly stated, with him and his dad, and also in Kamatipadam, is that something incidental or was that a very specific choice?
Father. As a character?
No, I mean, not just the father son relationship or father daughter relationship, but dysfunctional families in general?
Nothing very specific about it, but Steve Lopez was not a, it happens like only after his realization these things come in. In Anniyan Rasoolum, there is a backstory to Anna's dad, which is actually a which I couldn't shoot because it was getting longer, so I decided to cut it across. But dysfunctional, yeah, in a way, but nothing that much planned. It was just happened with the story, I think.
Is actually, you can say that it's a very functional family.
Functional family.
Because it is how it has to function. And then Steve becomes an aberration to that absolute function of the family, right? I understand what you're saying though, but yeah, that's the question.
When you said that there is something, like with your earlier films, I haven't seen Steve Lopez, like you said, but that it has to reach to people, you want to communicate with the audience. So, and that is how the ending changed in your mind, you know, that he acts on it, and he acts on what he observes. But isn't like, I don't know, isn't that the whole thing? I mean, how do you choose to act? Right. I mean, you choose to act on violence with, I don't know, but this... I think this is like, I feel like what we crave to watch on screen is somehow, you know, all of our fantasies, you know, even in our head, maybe I'm imagining killing somebody, you know, and all that. So, you know, that is what we crave and that is what we go to the screen to watch. But isn't that like, you know, like this violence begets violence and then it's just mindless violence and, you know, so I don't understand if this is... Really?
We had a very similar debate with the scriptwriter also, because we went on talking about this, because we also end up doing a violent act there. Uh-huh. But I don't know what, that time I wanted Krishnan to act on it.
Yeah.
It happened to be a very aggressive and violent thing of kicking him out of the thing, but personally, it must be the anger, something like that. But we had a similar thing. We didn't want to end it with us. For me, it was Krishnan's death. Krishnan witnessing all this, losing his friend, losing his city. Everything is gone. And he dies on the way back. Where the journey ends, Krishnan's life also ends. But then I wanted that end in the film. It was a very personal decision.
Yeah. Kamatipada.
How much of Kamati Padam was non-fictional on a scale of 1 to 10? Because when I watched the movie, the most striking part was it had a lot of details to it, like real details, unlike many gangster movies that I've seen, which fits into a certain narrative. But what happened in Kamati Padam was it had a very realistic touch, because once you get into a gangster area or something, coming back to a mainstream society is very difficult. So there's that... What I observed was Dulka, he keeps going back to the gangster lifestyle for Ganga. There's, like how we say, there's honor among the thieves. So it seems very personal and very realistic. So how much was it? How much autobiographical
was it?
And second thing was your research also. It feels like you have put in a lot of effort in your research.
Yeah. So. See, nothing autobiographical about it, but these things used to happen around us. No? You must have witnessed it in Bangalore also. It's all around us. And for me, people, when they ask me that, so many people have told me that the families didn't go for your film because of the violence. My friend, my classmates say that we cannot take our kids and wife to your films. You know, it's that kind of violence, they are scared of that violence, but it's happening all around you. It's happening, you get to read that in the newspapers, you get to see it in the television. Violence is more than what is in my cinema, actually.
So, Kochi had this dark underbelly of violence.
Every city has that. Every city has that dark thing. And I'm sure even Bangalore also has a lot of stories, you know. Every city has, and these things are actually, I know in Kerala, I know a lot of stories in every city.
Sir, you said the process was organic. Was the idea of having multiple narratives, that also was organic, or was it how you wrote the screenplay?
No, narrative was properly designed.
So you had the three parallel narratives decided, it was always decided.
There was actually Murthy's idea. Murthy's here. Murthy was also part of the initial discussions. So that the idea of the bus going back from that one travel to the train and going back and forth, that was actually challenging also. I just want to figure out whether we can execute it. one of the very the transitions are very has to be very specific there.
Was that something that came at the existing stage or?
No, that all that was planned.
Planned.
Very planned. The okay. Transitions were planned.
Decided.
The point from where you go to that, those were decided earlier.
Before we close, it's late. I want to ask something totally different from this film. It's something Anurag says in an interview about your work. Let me read what he says. Rajiv and me don't discuss much. I mean, after we discuss the script and the story, he goes out, and this is interesting, and he buys paintings from around the world. That's how he sees the film, and then some painter paintings become the reference for the film. So that's an interesting thing. What's the relation with painting that you have in your work? And colors and cities and colors, what's the...
Basically to get inspired, you know, like you try to search for things which can inspire you to shoot the film. You heard somebody's film vision, he's told you a story and you want to try and relate it to an image or images and somehow place it in a certain thing. For me, actually with Anurag, Gully Yellow Boot was happened from a photograph, the colors and the feel of it. It was a painting painting from somebody from France. I don't even remember the name now, but it's just something which inspires you. So I kind of share it with him, and if he agrees, then we just go ahead with doing it.
But that is something you do all the time.
I do it all the time.
You
actually.
Do it all the time. So
from institute days, that's been a practice, you know.
So Kamatipadam, what kind of art?
Kamatipadam, see, Hopper has been a constant inspiration. For almost all my films, there is something of a Hopper in every film which I have shot also. But this was, I tried and I was looking at a lot of earlier Cochin painters from Cochin, from Kerala and all. I just went through all these things and something, I don't remember the specific names and all, but I have been into it. I have looked into paintings and photographs and all that. I collected a lot of photographs, collected a lot of black and white. Kamatipadam starts from post-emergency. Is exactly after emergency to the present. So that way a lot of things were collected. Images has to be there for inspiration.
That's interesting. I would have liked to hear more about those specifics. But anyway, one last thing that I want to ask, and probably, which is basically about you being a cinematographer and a director. So I was thinking, if you look at pre-digital time, a director sets a frame, like actors, instructs actors, gives instructions to a cinematographer, and in some sense then the director has to step back, right? I mean, there's no monitor. You have to actually look at the scene in your mind, right? It's actually left to it. So like in a film, like people who don't watch shootings, I remember a sequence in Nadodi Kattu, it's a Malayalam film, where Ravi Shashi is shooting, and he says at some point, oh, this shot didn't work, let's reshoot it. But he's not looking at the monitor. I mean, he's kind of seeing it in his eye. But right now, the director can see exactly what the cinematographer sees. What's the relationship between the cinematographer and the director? How does that get constituted? Now, it doesn't seem to be like before, right? Something new is happening.
The problem is not the director. It's like a lot of other people also watching it. So a lot of ideas come in. But it's basically a trust or a faith. It used to be the earlier. There was a good feeling about it. But it still exists. It's not like... I find the problem with the other people around the monitor, not the director.
So, but do you enjoy this existence of monitor when you're a cinematographer or when you're a director? Like, you've been on both sides of this problem, no?
See, my practice has been... See, I've worked with Girish Kasaravelli in Thai Saib and all. So, that was my initial assisting days. So, when I saw him working, it was basically no monitor, nothing, but he was very particular about the lens, the positioning, the height, the dressing of the... even the setting up of the place. So that is the kind of schooling we also got. And I worked with directors in Kerala who didn't want to, there was no need for monitors. They could actually look at the camera who didn't understand the operation also. So I've gone through that. So it's kind of easy for me. I don't look at the monitor or anything nowadays. Even when I'm directing also, only when it is needed. I prefer to look at the actors that way.
I thought there was something interesting to think about the shifting relationship between the cinematographer and the director, just because of the existence of this monitor.
Yeah, cinematographer has become a very,
functional. I didn't say optional, I said functional. Well, I could take one last question and then we can end if there's one. But
I think so.
Hi, how do you stylize a film? Like, Overall, it constitutes the pacing of the final movie. And if I see Kamatipadam, 40 to 50% is in slow motions, and you have transitions in. So do you really plan this while writing? Like, would this be a part which helps the audience understand things better, or is it just a stylizing quotient for the entire film? Like shooting in a 60 FPS or 20 FPS, or is it planned, or?
No, it's not planned that way. Demand comes from the thing, or it happens. You're not looking at, only when you see the performance of what is happening there, you decide on something at that instant. Those kind of technical things are all happening there.
Anyway, I'm sure this conversation can go on for a long time, I know, but we have to stop. Thanks, Rajiv. Thanks for films. Thanks for the conversation. We're looking forward to the 4-hour cut for your next film.
And we can maybe screen that again at Urban Lens.
Yeah, sure. And I would suggest Steve Lopez as a film that will fit the Urban Lens imagination, because it's also not seen much. So thanks again. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you so much, Ratish. And we start again tomorrow at 10 a.m. We start with a Harun Farooqi film. So please do come. Thank you so much. Thank you.